Oh my goodness, it's a chicken roundup.
This is like your big treat.
Politicians used to promise a chicken in every pot, and it's no wonder. Almost everyone loves chicken and turkey, and I'm going to introduce you to duck. Poultry is so versatile and inexpensive. Today, a tribute to our fine feathered friends.
On a new segment we call Ask Sara, I'll demystify carving the bird with my tried and true secrets. Let me tell you, there's one little thing you need to do, and you will never go back to carving the old way again. Then we're on to delicious duck. I've got a recipe using prepared duck confit, leeks, and sauerkraut. Just 5 ingredients make a dish perfect for a cold night. It's sure to be a new favorite. And later we'll tour New York's Chinatown with Top Chef contestant Dale Talde. Then he'll share one of my all-time favorite recipes, angry chicken. It might be called angry chicken, but it'll make your family very happy.
The bird is the word. Today on Sara's Weeknight Meals. Funding provided by
Subaru builds vehicles like the versatile Subaru Forester, with symmetrical all-wheel drive and plenty of cargo room. A recipe made for whatever the day brings. Subaru, a proud sponsor of Sara's Weeknight Meals.
Family-owned and Indiana-grown, Maple Leaf Farms is a proud sponsor of Sara's Weeknight Meals. Providing a variety of duck products for home kitchens, Maple Leaf Farms duck helps inspire culinary adventures everywhere. Maple Leaf Farms.
Ezra's Feta Cheese, family made for more than a century.
I just love duck confit. It's one of my all-time favorite things. What it is duck from southwest of France that has been spiced and seasoned and then left to marinate for several days and then cooked low and slow in duck fat. It is so delicious, but it's time consuming. So you can imagine how thrilled I was to find it online, already prepared. So the first thing I do is I separate out the fat and the juice because those are going to be used in the recipe. And here are my duck legs. So I'm going to get started. We're going to re-crisp them first and then finish cooking them in the oven. And then I'm going to add all these other wonderful ingredients. So let me start by getting my ducks in the cold pan. And it's going to crisp up with some of this duck fat that I saved. Let me get them in the pan and talk a little bit about duck and duck fat. So skin side down, we want crispy skin. That's one of the things we love about duck confit. And if I need more fat, I'll add it, but the skin's going to give off even more fat. Okay, so turning it on to medium, and we're just going to let that crisp away, and pretty soon it's going to start talking to us. We'll hear all these crackling noises. So while that is crisping up, I'm going to get the rest of the recipe ready. Very simple. So we need to get some leeks going. Just cut off right where the roots are attached to the leek. The part we're going to use is the white part down here, because the green part's pretty tough. So what I like to do is to actually cut it up first and then wash it. And that's what I recommend that you do unless you're serving the leeks whole. So I just cut it in quarters like that, and now I'm gonna cut it in chunks. And if you can't find leeks, certainly you could use onions, that would be fine. But these days, I think you can always find leeks. Leeks are wonderful, they're in the onion family. I just love them. They're sort of milder, but they're really delicious. Okay, I'm gonna take these back and wash them and get rid of any sand that might be in there. So what I do is I fill up a bowl with water and then I put the leeks in. And the idea being is that if there's any sand in there, it goes to the bottom and the leeks go to the top. So we separate the two. And then what I do, instead of dumping the whole thing out, which would put the sand right on top of the leeks, is I just lift them right out and put them into a colander. This is how you wash lettuce. This is how you wash spinach. They're clean. We're good to go. I'm gonna get them in the pan. Wow, I bet you my duck is ready. Let me have a look. Let's see, we're just looking. Wow, that's A+. Okay, I'm gonna get it out of the pan and into a roasting pan. I'm gonna pop it in the 350 degree oven, and this is just to finish heating it through. Remember, it's completely cooked. And then we're gonna save that yummy duck fat in there. Oh boy, this is why I love it. I just love skin. Okay, into a 350 degree oven for about 20 minutes. All we're doing is reheating it. And then while that is heating up, I'm gonna finish my sort of mélange of vegetables that are gonna be underneath the duck confit. So in go my leeks, and yeah, they're wet, which you normally wouldn't put something wet into a hot pan, but I think we're gonna be fine. I'm leaving the fat that was left from the duck. And what we wanna do with the leeks is just soften them. So about 10, 12 minutes. We could get color on them too, actually. That would be fine. When I say color, caramelize them a little bit. And I'm gonna season them. I like to season as I go. So a little salt and a little pepper. All right, very briefly, let me talk about duck fat. Duck fat is actually not all saturated fat. A huge percentage of it has the same properties as olive oil. It's got mono and polyunsaturated fat in it, as well as saturated fat. So duck fat is actually not so bad for you. As a matter of fact, in some cases, it's sort of good. So let me let this cook, and now I'm cutting my mushrooms. So now I'm just gonna trim and slice these. You could use any mushrooms you like. I like them all. I never met a mushroom I didn't like. And, you know, so you just use whatever you can find. I'm cutting these in half because it's easier to slice a mushroom when it's flat than when it's round, and then you can just slice them easily. And these are gonna go right in with my leeks, which have got some color in them. I've gotta move quickly and get these in. So these guys are going in with the leeks, and we're gonna give them a few more minutes. So now while those are cooking, let me talk to you about sauerkraut. Now we associate sauerkraut with Germany, and certainly it's an important part of German cuisine, and sauerkraut is salted cabbage. That's how we get all that liquid, because you salt it. But apparently thousands of years ago, when they were building the Great Wall of China, the laborers used to eat a similar version of it, which was shredded cabbage that had been preserved in rice vinegar. Interesting. Okay, so now I'm gonna add the sauerkraut, and I added some of the juice with it. Some chicken broth. And finally, remember that duck juice that I saved? The duck juice. And all we need to do now is to reduce it down until it's almost dry, just a little bit of liquid in there. And we're good to go. I'm gonna go check my duck. I've been smelling it. It's been driving me bananas. It smells so good. Oh yeah. Beautiful. So I'm gonna start with a little bit of our leek mixture underneath, and we're gonna put the duck right on top. Remember, this is just for two, so I can be generous. Just a little more liquid. And then, oh yeah, I think I'll pick this guy. Whoa, there we go. Oh, yummy. And I'm just serving it with a simple green salad with some carrots, cherry tomatoes, and a little bit of ricotta salata. So there you go, my duck with braised leeks and sauerkraut. Just 5 ingredients, and it was so simple because the duck was cooked and ready to go to begin with. I'm just gonna finish it off with a little fresh thyme. I get many questions from viewers on my website, saramoulton.com, and I love answering them. One question I get every Thanksgiving is, how do I carve the big bird? Well, whether it's chicken, turkey, or duck, it's all the same. However, there is one little trick that will make the job so much easier. Watch this.
Isn't that beautifully cooked? All right, make sure you take the temperature of the turkey. I'm gonna show you on me. Don't think I'm silly. Here's the leg, here's the thigh. You wanna stick the thermometer on the inside. I'm gonna show you as if this is the leg and this is the thigh and we're tucked up right against the turkey. Where we're gonna put the thermometer is right in here, but we're not gonna touch the bone. If you feel the bone, rummage around to get away from the bone. That's where you want to take the temperature of the turkey. What we're looking for is 165 degrees. Good news. When you see that it's at 165, take it out and let it rest. This is so, so, so important. I'm going to let this rest for 30 to 60 minutes to let all the juices redistribute in the bird so it stays nice and moist. Trust me, it will stay rip-roaring hot out of the oven for a whole hour. And when we come back, I'll get carving. So the first thing I'm gonna do is I'm gonna move the turkey onto the cutting board. And over the years, I've realized a lot of people make a lot of mistakes that are easy to avoid, starting with forgetting to remove the wishbone. You probably didn't even know that you had to in order to carve well. You probably just thought it was a little gimmick for the kids. You can see where the wishbone is because it shows you that it's down in here. There's a yummy piece of skin, and it goes right in there. You have to go in with a tip of a very sharp little knife, just do a little excavation to find where the wishbone is. And just run your knife down either side of the wishbone. This takes time, so be patient. But it will make a huge difference when you're carving later on. You'll understand the method to my madness.
Okay, there we go. We have the wishbone. Next, we're going to take off the leg thigh. Just cut the skin and then push the leg down. That is the ball and socket joint right there. And that is what we want to pop. That is where the point is that the leg was attached. Okay, there is our leg thigh. Now, I'm going to take the breast off. You know the breastbone goes right down the middle. So you try to find it and go on one side, the side that you're going to start on. Now, if I hadn't taken the wishbone out here, I would keep hitting it as I go down. It would have been right in my way. I would have left all that breast meat on the bird. Okay, and when you get here, you just cut it off the wing. You could have taken off the wing first if you wanted to. Okay, we have all the parts that we need that we're going to slice up. I'll take this off, it makes it easier. Ha ha ha. Maybe save it for myself. And just slice the meat straight down in thin slices. Well, I'm gonna do some dark meat. But again, you could just do that fast. Okay, you put a nice assortment of dark meat and white meat on the platter. If in the process of carving your turkey has gotten cold, just take a little hot broth and spoon it over the top.
Where I live, New York's Chinatown is the best place to shop for Asian food and ingredients. And the best person to shop with is Dale Talde, frequent Top Chef contestant and an expert in almost every Asian cuisine.
Hey, Dale, how are you?
Sarah, how are you?
We met at the Egg Custard King, one of the Chinese bakeries that dot every block down here.
Very nice. I like it.
Wow, what a cool place. So you used to like come in here, this bakery?
Yeah, yeah, it was on my way to work. I just stopped in here and head to work.
Well, you're gonna have to tell me what to order because I'm clueless.
So for me, their egg tarts are amazing. Some of these sweet desserts are kind of a new thing in Chinese cuisine. The pastries, as you see them now, are relatively new style of baking in Chinese cuisine.
How did that happen?
I think it's the influence from the British and the European influence into China, into Hong Kong. Because you can really see that these look like tea pastries.
Right.
Pastries you would have with tea.
Oh, I see.
Obviously,
of course.
Tea being
yeah.
very popular
yeah.
in China. Yeah. So for me, it's if you want to go sweet, you can't
what
go wrong
these?
With some of these
so
egg
what's
custards.
The difference between the yellow and the coconut?
Yellow is a basic vanilla custard.
Okay.
And this is just with the addition of coconut.
I think I'm going to go with the basic one.
Yeah.
So what should I get to drink?
So you know bubble tea being the rage now, I think you should go with the bubble tea.
Yeah, no, my daughter loves it. You young people. So which flavor should I get?
Yeah, try the Horlicks. I mean, that okay. is like a very classic malted drink that was brought over.
Bubble tea doesn't actually have bubbles. It has giant pearls of flavored tapioca, and it takes a big straw to drink it.
Ooh, we got one. Woo, I caught a fish. Wow, that is sweet.
Woo! Like the sugar here.
Okay, I'm gonna try this. You can have some too. You're right, look at how flaky that is. Mm. Wonderfully flaky. Look at all those different layers in there. It's just
yeah,
extraordinary.
It's a beautifully laminated dough. I think it's a version of puff, but not using butter.
So how do they get all those layers?
Probably lard. Lard and water. And that's where they're pulling their fats from because they didn't have, there's no cows there.
I love that bubble tea.
Yeah, so, the taro.
Yeah.
Fortified for our shopping trip, we hit the streets and markets of Chinatown. Dale knows them well.
So you used to live near her. Did you shop here?
Yeah, like 2 blocks away, yeah. I mean, for me, it's more an inspiration, really. On the way to work when I was at Budokan, on my way to work, I would take a little detour, stop here.
What are those red
things?
Yeah,
and I would just really buy whatever I kind of didn't know what was what.
And then you just, wow.
Kind of figure out how to use them.
And you can understand why. There are things here you would never see at your local supermarket.
These are a type of water spinach.
I just saute it real quick.
Yeah, or put them in soups.
What are these orange things?
They are a type of Caribbean squash.
And these big guys over here?
I think they call it Indian squash, but like.
So what's it taste like?
Really very, it's very bland. It takes on flavors.
Okay, so it like absorbs the sauce.
Yeah.
So we gotta pick up ingredients. So where are we going now?
Yeah, this is Asian Market. We're gonna get some of the Southeast Asian ingredients we need.
This is the place?
This is the place to go.
So what do we need to get?
So we need to get some fish sauce.
Okay, let's start with that.
Great.
I know there's lots of brands, right?
Tons.
There's
tons,
like
tons, tons.
Several different styles depending on what
yeah.
country it comes from.
Mm-hmm. Philippines, Thailand, Vietnam.
Uh-huh. What are you looking for in a fish sauce?
Typically in fish sauce, a clean flavor.
Mm-hmm. Which one would you buy?
This is the one I would buy. They're graded by the amount of protein
mm-hmm.
that's in the actual fish sauce.
Mm-hmm.
And this particular brand has a higher protein
content
than other brands. So it means it's not watered down, it's a pure flavor. The actual flavor of the anchovies, you can really taste the the essence of the anchovy in this fish sauce. And it's a cleaner brand.
I could eat my way through Chinatown, but I think we gotta get cooking.
I know, I'm starving.
I'm making some incredible Asian dishes today with Chef Dale Talde.
Hi, Sara.
And this is one of your signature dishes. It's angry chicken?
Yes.
Whoa. Okay, we're gonna toast the spices first here.
Sure. Mm-hmm.
And then we'll talk about the recipe, but I just wanna get these in the pan. So we have a teaspoon each of coriander and a teaspoon of fennel seed, and then a half a teaspoon of black pepper and one lone green cardamom pod.
It's very strong.
And you just put a mere 3 cups of hot sauce in there.
Yes, kind of where the term angry chicken came from.
Ah, okay, that makes sense. And as if that wasn't enough, what else goes in there?
We add a teaspoon of turmeric.
And that's for color or?
For color. Teaspoon of paprika.
Uh-huh, you like paprika.
Also to fortify it with some color.
Okay.
And the little sweetness from the
paprika. So you really
paprika.
Think about color too?
I think you have to. I think, they say you eat with your eyes first, and I think it's true.
Yeah.
A little chili powder, yep. 1 teaspoon. And then 1 teaspoon of garlic powder.
Okay.
And we add 1 tablespoon of fish sauce. Fish sauce is a natural form of salt and umami.
Yeah, it's like that last, sense of taste. So mm-hmm. you got sweet, sour, salty, bitter, umami.
And to this we add, I know it's an unusual ingredient, chicken bouillon.
Excuse me, as chef, using a little chicken bouillon cube?
Yeah.
I'm gonna tell.
It's just kind of stacking flavor, you know, reinforcing that chicken flavor.
All right, and you wanna just explain why we are toasting these whole spices?
We do toast the spices to kind of release the essential oils, and once you smell it, then that's when those spices are toasted.
I think I am smelling it, yes.
You totally smell that.
Okay, so then we're gonna grind it. You want me to put it in there?
Sure.
Okay, and I'm gonna go get the yogurt. Okay, let's just hope I get it in there. Now, a little trick, if you happen to use, as I do, a grinder for your coffee beans. Actually, this would make them sort of interesting, your coffee, right? If there was residual spices in there. But the way you can clean this is to put a piece of bread in there. After you ground up the spices, take them out, put in a piece of bread, grind it up, wipe it out. You got it clean, pretty much, right?
Absolutely.
Okay, so I'm gonna get some yogurt. We're just using regular full-fat yogurt?
Yes.
Okay. And what do we need, about a pound?
Yeah, about 1 pound of yogurt.
And you serve this in your restaurant, is one of the dishes?
Yeah, we serve this at the restaurant, but we actually deep fry.
Wow.
So it's a fried chicken.
But we're gonna roast it today because we want to keep it a little healthier for the home cook.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. The marinade we make is also the dipping sauce for the table.
Oh, that's convenient.
Absolutely.
I love that color.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so this is just this is two breasts of pressed wings and two leg thighs. Okay, I'm gonna massage them in there.
We're gonna marinate this for 24 hours, but this marinade will keep the bird for at least 4 to 5 days.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
And I bet it gets better tasting.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And it
tenderizes.
Tenderizes.
That's what yogurt, I forgot. I mean, that dairy is a tenderizer and yogurt's got the double whammy of the acid and the milk. Okay, I'm gonna go hose down.
Okay.
And you're gonna, we have some that we've already marinated.
Yeah.
For a couple days. So this is something you could even like set up on Sunday and then, you come home one night from work and you just pop it in the oven. You do use a lot of marinade for this, right?
Mm-hmm.
Sort of silky. Okay, so we're gonna put this in a 400 degree oven for, 40 minutes?
About 40 minutes.
Okay, I'm gonna go hose down again. That's my job.
I'll put this back in, I'll put this in the oven.
You know, while that's baking, it takes 40 minutes, right?
Mm-hmm.
Let's go for a walk.
Sure.
So, how's Pork Slope going?
I mean, it's going good.
Yeah?
You know?
I love the title. I mean, that's just so brilliant.
Thank you. 2 years ago, I went back to the Philippines. It was amazing. My parents always referred to going back to the Philippines as going home. It made me feel good to finally kind of understand the culture and to see what they meant by that. I understood that this is their home and this is kind of my home.
Yeah.
You know, I was born and raised in Chicago, but my culture is of the Philippines, you know.
So do you think you'd ever go back and open up, say, a Pork Slope in the Philippines?
I mean, I would love the opportunity. I mean, right now I'm trying to make my bones and trying to start a family in Brooklyn.
Yeah.
So that's kind of where
Brooklyn
I'm at.
Brooklyn first, the Philippines next. That smells so good. Here, I'll close the door. Oh, wow. Now, how do we get the color on top? Does that just happen, or do we have to, you have to put it under the broiler a little bit sometimes?
Yeah, after about 40 minutes, sometimes you might have to, depending on how high your
oven
is,
yeah.
Just to get that nice char and to get it crispy.
All right, so you'll plate that, and I've got our wonderful baby bok choy. There we go. Yay! All right. Ooh, so what is this exciting colored drink?
So this is one of the cocktails we serve at the restaurant. It's called the Obama Punch.
Ooh, very refreshing.
We wanted to taste like punch.
Mmm, it does sure as heck taste like punch. There's like a million different things in there. Whoa, I like that. All right, so chicken time. Okay, I'm just gonna go like that. I know we have nice serving spoons. Oh, okay. And I wanna put some of that yummy sauce on top of it. Ooh, boy. Oh, wow. Mm. Oh, wow. I think that is the moistest chicken I've ever had.
Thank you.
Ooh, and it is a little bit angry back there.
Yeah.
Thank you all for joining me and Dale Talde here, and I'll see you next time for more of Sara's Weeknight Meals. All right. Yogurt's great, too.
I like it.
I like yogurt, I like it. Mm.
You really taste the spices, like.
You can.
You know, it develops.
Sara's Weeknight Meals continues online. For recipes, helpful tips, messages, and lots more, visit us on the web at saramoulton.com/weeknightmeals.
Funding provided by
Subaru builds vehicles like the versatile Subaru Forester with symmetrical all-wheel drive and plenty of cargo room. A recipe made for whatever the day brings. Subaru, a proud sponsor of Sara's Weeknight Meals.
Family-owned and Indiana-grown, Maple Leaf Farms is a proud sponsor of Sara's Weeknight Meals. Providing a variety of duck products for home kitchens, Maple Leaf Farms Duck helps inspire culinary adventures everywhere. Maple Leaf Farms.
Ezra's Feta Cheese, family-made for more than a century.